Welcome back, everyone, to The Xamarin Show. I'm your host, James Montemagno, and today I'm super happy to have my second favorite Wisconsinite, Matthew, with me. How's it going, Matthew?
Thanks, James. Thanks for having me on. Second favorite? Well, I'm working up there.
It's going to be hard to beat the first one. So, Matthew, all the way in, cloud developer advocate now here at Microsoft, which is awesome. Congratulations.
Oh, Welcome to the team. Thank you very much.
Yeah, so what are you going to be showing us today?
Today, I want to talk about some little gems of awesomeness called behaviors in Xamarin.Forms.
Oh, awesome. I actually don't know too much about behaviors, so that's why I had the expert come on to tell us about it. But if people don't know who you are, maybe you can let them know a little bit.
All right. My name is Matt Soucoup. As James mentioned, I'm a cloud developer advocate here at Microsoft. And so what I do is I advocate for Azure as a mobile developer. So I'm going to help mobile developers learn how to use Azure. And also, if you're having issues, I can go back to the engineering teams and help you out that way, too. Yeah.
And you've been in the Xamarin community for a long time, right?
Yeah. I've been using it since way back when we were calling it MonoTouch and MonoDroid.
Oh, yeah. Me too.
Yeah.
And we connected a long time together back in Wisconsin.
Yep.
You ran a user group there. Mm-hmm. And I've been trying to hire you for years. Little did anyone know that it only took whole acquisition of Microsoft to make it happen. So we're super happy to have you here.
Oh, yeah. I love being here. Yeah. Thanks, James.
So, behavior. So everyone, we've had lots of videos on Xamarin.Forms. I've talked a lot about MVVM. What is a behavior? Like, why would someone use a behavior?
So a behavior is nothing but a C-sharp class that extends the functionality of a built-in control.
Okay.
So here's an example. Let's say you have an entry, and you want that entry to validate an email address.
Okay.
And that way, you can just put on a behavior, type in an email address, and you can tell then on an entry control whether it's good or not.
Mm. So it's a little piece of, let me see if I got this right. So it's like a little piece of reusable
totally
functionality reusable that you attach to any control.
You can attach it to any control.
Got it.
And the utility of these guys really sneaks up on you.
Okay.
And let me explain that for just a little bit. So I was talking about like validating an email address. You can also do cool things like make a control be a command where you don't have a command, like on an entry text change event.
Oh, cool. Gotcha. So usually you'd have to register for all those events. But you can say, hey, when someone enters it, run this I command.
Right.
Ah,
right.
That's cool.
Then we're not messing up our code behind in the background.
Got it.
Or in the case of that entry control, subclassing the whole entry control, and then we have just an entry that's an email validator entry, which is maybe a bit much.
Got it. So do you have access to the control as well in the behavior? How does that work? Like, what is the structure of a behavior?
Yeah, well, let's jump into some code and find out.
Yeah, let's do it.
All right, so first let me show you the app that we're going to be customizing here and adding a behavior to.
Okay.
All right, so let's bring it up. And James, I use this app all the time. So I'm going to show it to you. You can use it too if you want.
Okay.
And it's how does my beard look every day?
Today, it looks real good.
Right. And so it does one thing. You wake up in the morning and you can just say, my beard look fair, good, cool, great, or magnificent.
Yours does look, mine's like at a good. Yours is probably at a magnificent.
I would say we're both at magnificent. So, but that's all this does here. And what we're going to do is, based on what we pick down here in a picker, we're going to change the background color of this.
Oh, cool.
Of the picker.
Yeah. And I would think, so if I was to do this manually, I'm thinking I would probably register for an event whenever the value changed, and then I could do it in one of two ways. That could be listening to a bindable property, and then the background color could be another bindable property, but now I'm kind of mixing my UI together.
Right.
So maybe I just register for the event and then manually change it with a switch. That's kind of like my mind of, which is kind of like ugly code, right?
It's not ugly
elegant.
Code.
Right. It's not magnificent.
It's not magnificent. Okay. I mean, that's probably right down at the fair.
Fair.
Right. So let's do a simple picker validator where you kind of do not the greatest code, but or the more the fair code, but it'll work. So what a behavior is that we inherit from the behavior class.
Okay.
And then we say that we want to attach to a picker.
Oh, so it's strongly typed then. So
it's strongly typed.
Oh, okay.
And it doesn't necessarily need to be at picker. Could be an entry, or it could be further down the inheritance tree.
Like so a view.
It could be a view.
Oh, cool. Because if it's something generic like, oh, I just want to change the background color based on the time of day, right? That could be it.
Yeah, exactly. And then there's two functions here that we can override, that we want to override. And one is called onAppearing. So override on appearing, on attached to, and this is where you're getting for before, James, and we have access to the picker here.
Okay, so on attached to, that's on the main one. To. So is that when it's loaded?
That's
or
when
what?
The picker, when the behavior gets added to the control itself.
Got it.
This gets called.
Okay.
And this is where we can start doing fun things like handling events here, where we want to actually do the overriding or extending of the control.
Cool. And you renamed, it was just generic, and you just put picker in
right.
there because you know it's a
right.
picker.
Exactly, because right now I know it's a picker. So before it was just bindable object, so
got
I changed that over.
Cool.
So what I'm going to do here is I'm going to say bindable, the name of my variable, and then all the way up here I'm going to handle my event,
got
select
it
in exchange, and then I will do that, name my event handler, and put it down there.
Perfect.
And then I have another function I want to override. And that's going to be on detaching from.
So attach to, detaching from.
Right.
I'm going to imagine you may want to unsubscribe to this event.
Exactly.
Yeah. Clean up a little bit
exactly.
of your memory. Got it.
Right. And that's going to be selected and exchanged. Again.
Oh, there you go.
Picker. Minus equals, and then bindable. Of course, I picked the wrong one.
Got it. Cool.
All right.
So this is pretty easy. So a behavior, this kind of looks familiar to an effect in a way. All right.
Right.
That's kind of my imagining, because mm-hmm. I remember there's like an attach to, detach to.
Right.
Then maybe if developers have made an effect, how would this behavior differ from an effect?
It's very similar to an effect.
Okay.
It's almost analogous to it, except you're not dealing with any platform-specific functionality at
Got
this point.
Got it. I'm essentially attaching to this behavior, which is this control, and I really only care about the cross-platform UI.
Exactly.
UI implementations.
Exactly.
Okay, cool. That makes
right.
sense. Got
yep.
it.
Yep. So then now we actually have, when this function handler gets called, this event handler, this sender coming in is actually going to be our picker.
Got it.
So what I'm just going to do is I'm going to say var, I'll just call it bindable, equals, and I'm just going to assume it's going to be the picker right away.
Yeah.
And go like that. So now I have a reference to my picker.
Cool.
And so my logic here is going to be very simple. I'm going to check whether it's valid or not, just based on the number of items in my list.
Okay.
So I'm going to say if, let's see, bindable dot selected index is greater than or equal to bindable.items.count divided by 2. So if it's in the greater half of the overall there, we're just going to keep it at the same color.
What's this magical thing that you have? What is that? What's going on here?
Right here?
Yeah, what is that?
It's a ligature in the, I'm not sure, the font community. And it's called Fira code. It's
okay,
an open source coding. And what it does, it puts these cool ligatures on it, so it makes these things look more like...
A little bit nicer.
Yeah.
Got it. Okay. Just so anyone was curious.
Yeah.
Okay, I'm curious. I have no idea. I just use the defaults. I'm a
yep.
default type of guy. Okay.
So if it is valid, then what we're going to say, the bindable dot background color is going to be equal to, we'll just keep it at color default. Else, if we're not valid, if we're in the bottom half of our colors, we're going to do bindable dot background color. And my favorite invalid color is always probably salmon.
Gotta have Google salmon.
Yep.
Yeah. Okay.
All right.
This looks easy. I like this. I like easy code. Understandable.
Right.
Yep.
Straightforward. Really, this is the same stuff that we would be writing in our code behind file if we were going that way, but we're making it reusable, putting it in its own file. And this is sole purpose in this behavior's life is to validate that we're in the top half of our total number of items in the list.
And this could be anything. It could be another picker for something else that's not beard related per
exactly.
se.
Yep, we're just
cheese related.
Cheese related, exactly.
Yes. Got it. So how do you get it in the XAML? Because to me, I'm a XAML type of guy.
Me too.
Look it up.
All right, so here's the behaviors page that I'm calling it, and I have the picker right down here.
Got it.
So all we need to do, there is a collection on every control called behaviors.
Got it. Because there's behavior. And they go into the behaviors.
Right, exactly.
Got it. And you get multiple behaviors.
You can add multiple behaviors to a single control.
Got it.
So let's call behave yours. And then all you need to do is, because I already added the namespace, is like this. So I added the local namespace up here just to reference it. And then local simple picker behavior.
That's it. And that's very similar to if you've done any on platforms or you've done effects or anything. That was very similar code.
Exactly.
It's in, I think the important part here is that it's in the behaviors list.
Exactly.
Got it. Okay.
Exactly. So let's run it now. Let's see what happens.
I'm ready.
Yes.
Yes.
So it's going to redeploy, bring it back out. And initially we're fair. Not that great.
Not that great.
Click on it and we'll go right to magnificent. Perfect.
Very cool. Nice.
Perfect.
Very cool. So reusable. And what's nice there is that you didn't have to interact with your view model, your model. Because what you're actually doing is kind of control-related activity to the UI-related activity.
Right.
That's where the behavior goes.
Right. Cool. Exactly.
Nice. So that's pretty simple, but what else you got? Is what I mean, because you're talking about some really cool, crazy stuff you can do.
So yeah. What I wanted to do next is, these things are gems of awesomeness. And what you can do with them is that you can start putting bindable properties into these behaviors. So I have another, what I'm calling picker color behavior.
Okay.
So what I can do with this is I can actually bind to the valid values that I'm sending in. So I can say, I want the magnificent value to be the valid value and all the rest of them to be bad.
Oh,
or good and magnificent to be the valid values.
Got it, okay.
And I can say what color I want to be valid. So we can start sending all these from the XAML page.
Got it.
And then down here, it's the exact same functionality in the onDetached to and onDetached from.
Got it.
And then in a selected index change, what I'm doing is a little more safe coding.
Got it.
Making sure that. And then getting the selected item, selected text, using some reflection to get it out.
Yep.
And then checking to see if it contains the selected text and
got
it out.
Okay, so what you're doing in this instance, you're kind of now extending the control with the behavior to add custom bindable properties.
Right.
Because there wasn't a is valid before or valid color invalid.
Correct.
You're adding value. You didn't subclass anything. You didn't create anything.
No.
But it's a behavior.
It's a behavior. It's changing the behavior of the picker to get an is valid values onto it, but it's really properties of the behavior.
Yeah, that's the key, right? So you're not extending the control. You are, but you're kind of extending the behavior. Oh, that's cool.
Yes, extending the behavior, which in turn extends the control.
And then you could pass the bindable properties down into the behavior?
Yep.
Oh, let's do it. That's cool.
All right.
Okay, got it.
So let's do that next. So in my view model behind the scenes, what I have is an observable collection of beard ratings, which we were looking at before. And then down here, I also have a static of valid ratings.
Got it.
So that's what's going on behind the scenes. And then I have it commented out, so we can just go and grab it. You don't have to. And I'll pop it in here so we can see what it looks like.
To get rid of the simple picker.
We'll get rid of the simple picker, and we'll put more of the advanced one in here.
So this valid values, those are things that obviously didn't exist on the behavior before, but you added those.
I added those.
The bindable properties.
Right. So we're saying the valid value is coming from the view model.
Got it.
And I'm saying invalid color being fuchsia this time.
Got it.
And so if we run it again.
And then fuchsia, since it is a color of a bindable, it knows how to do it automatically.
Exactly.
Cool.
Yeah, so we could set that from the view model as well.
Cool.
So fair is bad, but in this case, good is good. Cool is bad, great's bad, but magnificent, good.
That's good. And that's kind of nice because you may be adding stuff into the picker in different orders,
right?
And you may really want to figure out which one's which.
Exactly.
Oh, very cool. I like that.
So the last thing I wanted to show here with behaviors is actually making a control that doesn't have a command, so we can do our MVVM goodness.
So maybe first, what is a command? So maybe if you're brand new to MVVM, right, you saw some bindable stuff in there, but what is a command and why would you use one?
So a command is a way to tell a view model to do something in return from an event happening in the view.
What's an example?
An example would be a button click.
Got it, okay.
So you click a button, goes out to the view model, and the view model goes downloads your favorite list of cheeses from a website.
So it's Exactly. That's normally what it would do.
Yep.
So that replaces that plus equals clicked event?
Exactly.
Okay, got it. So you don't have to have access to the control. You say, is it bindable to that command?
Exactly.
And what does the command do? It just does some stuff?
The command just then does some stuff. It either calls out to a service of some sort or whatever you need it to do. So but it doesn't have access back to the view.
So why doesn't every single event handler have a command?
That's a good question.
Yeah. I don't know.
Yeah.
So that's what you want to do.
That's what I want to do.
Okay, got it. Yeah. Okay. So cool. How would you do that then?
Right. So I'm going to add that to an entry.
Okay.
And what I want for that entry is to have on its, on attaching to, on its text changed, I want to actually, every time you have a keystroke, to listen to that keystroke and then execute a command.
Okay, got it. That makes sense.
So again, I have a bindable property called the command. It's iCommand here. Mm-hmm. So I can set all that up in a XAML. On the unattached to, all I'm doing is making sure that the bindable coming in, the entry, if it's not the binding or the binding context is not equal to null, what I'm doing here is a little bit different. I'm setting the binding context of the behavior to be the binding context of the entry.
Okay.
To make sure they both have the same binding context.
Got it. Okay.
And then just handling the text change event.
Got it. Okay.
And so all we do in the text change event, make sure the command's set to something, and then execute it.
Oh, nice. Cool. That's easy peasy.
Yep. So then in the view model, here I have a really, really impressive text analytics sentiment analysis, deep machine learning.
Okay.
All right. So what we're doing is if the input contains fair, good, cool, or great, just changing the selected beard rating property. It'll update the picker. Ah. The picker will change its color. And here we go.
Cool.
All right. So back into the XAML. I'm going to grab this. Pop in here. Now we have a beard diary.
Okay.
So not only are we picking how our beard looks, we can also type in how it looks.
Very cool. And then very similar stuff. You have that local entry press command.
Yep.
But then it is to that entry press command.
So it's going back to the entry press command behind the scenes in the view model,
cool,
which is just calling in this parse beard text.
Nice.
All right. So right now it just says fair, but today my beard is good and automatically updates it.
Bam.
So every keystroke or every tap on the keyboard is update calling that command and going out.
Very cool. Yeah, that's really awesome. I mean, I like that it's for any control, easily extend. But I think the key that I'm noticing is that you didn't have to create a custom renderer, you didn't create a custom control, you didn't do anything. You're just kind of extending it naturally.
I'm extending the control naturally in a behavior that is self-contained. And what's cool is that I can start adding on multiple behaviors to that same control.
Yeah.
And I can reuse these behaviors wherever. I can put them into my own third-party library, let's call it, and put them with all my projects.
That's nice. So if you're creating your own custom reusable controls, boom, you can start extending it easily with behaviors. That's super cool. I now want to go take all my apps, replace a bunch of logic that is definitely hard-coded into my view models, and put them in behaviors.
Yep.
Awesome. Perfect. Well, thank you, Matthew, for coming on
and thanks for having me.
And chit-chatting about behaviors. I love it.
Awesome.
And we'll put all the links and the awesome beard application in the show notes below, so make sure to go check those out. That's it. This has been another Xamarin Show. Until next time, don't forget to subscribe up over there, down there, over here. Who knows? Ring that bell. Make sure you get those great notifications right in your inbox whenever a new Xamarin Show is posted. So until next time, I'm James Montemagno, and thanks for watching.